In this video, we will discuss recombination assays in bacteriophages. One characteristic of any recombination assay is the need for two copies of the genome to allow recombination. This is easy to do when both genomes are diploid. But how is it done with bacteriophages? Each bacteriophage contains only a single copy of its genome, and bacteriophages are haploid. The experimental condition would need to be chosen such that one bacterium would be infected by two bacteriophages. Let's talk about how this is done experimentally. A recombination assay is a two-step process. In the first step, the infection occurs in solution, where we have an excess of bacteriophages to infect a limited number of bacteria. So, the bacteria-to-bacteriophage ratio is chosen to be approximately 2 bacteriophages per bacterium. Therefore, recombination can happen between the two bacteriophage genomes inside a single bacterium. We incubate the solution until the bacteria lyse and release the bacteriophage progeny. These bacteriophages, which contain both parental and recombinant progeny, are isolated. Let's break down step one. A bacteria solution is co-infected with two types of rapid lysis T4 bacteriophage mutants, called R21 and R22. These two mutant types each carry a rapid lysis mutation in a different position along their genome. On the two genomes, the X's represent the position of the rapid lysis mutations. In rare cases, a recombination will occur between the positions of the two mutations, resulting in an exchange of chromosomes between the genomes of R21 and R22. This results in two new genomes, one containing both mutations, called R212, and one wild-type genome with no rapid lysis mutation. However, in most cases, the lack of recombination leaves the two parental genomes, R21 and R22, unchanged. Each of these four genomes will drive the production of new bacteriophages. Upon lysis, the progeny released contains four types of bacteriophages. The two parental rapid lysis bacteriophages, R21 and R22, and two recombinant bacteriophages, R212 and the wild type. The second step for this recombination assay is the analysis by a plaque assay of the phenotype of the progeny issued from the first step. The supernatant that is collected at the end of step one is plated onto bacteria. Bacteria are, this time, in excess compared to bacteriophages, and the bacteria-to-bacteriophage ratio is such that a bacterium cannot be infected by more than one bacteriophage. So, no recombinations should occur at this step. On the plate of bacteria, large plaques could come from three different bacteriophages. The single mutants, R21 and R22, as well as the double mutant, R212. Single and double lysis mutants produce large plaques of the same size. The wild-type bacteriophages produce small plaques. From here, we can calculate the frequency of recombination. The frequency of recombination is the total number of recombinants divided by the total number of progeny. To express the frequency of recombination as a percentage, we can multiply everything by 100. Counting the total number of plaques is simple. We just look at the plate and count. It's the number of small plaques plus the number of large plaques. However, determining the number of recombinants is a little more complicated. The number of wild types is easy to determine because we just count the small plaques. However, determining the number of double mutants is impossible because double and single mutants produce indistinguishable large plaques. But we know that each time a double mutant is formed, a wild type must be formed because it's a single recombination event that will give us one wild type and one double mutant. So, in fact, we do know the total number of recombinants. It's the number of wild types times 2. Therefore, the frequency of recombination is, in fact, 2 times the number of small plaques divided by the total number of plaques times 100. When recombination is a rare event, there are only a few small plaques among many large ones, which makes counting them very tricky. So, we would need to plate a lot of bacteriophages. Too many bacteriophages on one plate make all the plaques too close together, making it hard to count the small plaques. Seymour Benzer resolved a bacteriophage research issue by identifying differences in E. coli strains used by US and French scientists. Strain B, used in the US, and strain K, used in France, can both be infected by wild-type T4 and mutant bacteriophages. However, the rapid lysis mutant can only trigger lysis in strain B, forming large plaques, whereas strain K forms no plaques with the mutant. Both strains form small plaques with the wild-type T4 phage. Benzer proposed a variation of the previously described recombination. The first step is unchanged, with two strains of rapid lysis mutants and the bacterial strain B. The change is in the second step, where a sample of the first step progeny is plated on strain K and strain B. Both large and small plaques can be counted on plate B, while only small plaques are formed on plate K. Therefore, the plating on strain K can be done with a high concentration of bacteriophage without making counting small plaques difficult. This simplifies the detection of very low frequencies of recombination and the study of rapid lysis mutations that are very close along the bacteriophage genome. As long as step 2 is performed with an excess of bacteria compared to the number of bacteriophages, the frequency of recombination will be accurately determined.